All right, so we are live. I will just check when it goes up. There should be a small delay.
What is it, like 20 seconds or something?
Something like that. I'm also going to post on the Facebook that we're going. Just so that people can, you know, if they're looking for a post.
Yeah, it'll probably take a little while to build up, I guess, but,
Oh, I'm sure, yeah.
Oh, yeah, it looks like it's live.
Excellent. And of course, I have to mute it, because if I don't, it'll double produce all of our noise for some reason. If I don't mute the stream while it's
going. Silent, too.
Alrighty. So we are live. That is great. Chat on the side. Have that right there, so I can see if we have any drop frames. We shouldn't. We're good to go. So thank you again so much for agreeing to do this. This is great.
Yeah, no worries. It'll be fun.
Yeah. So let's make our ship. Game. What should we name our ship?
SSSGCV.
Alright. SSS? Alright.
I need to tweet about this, just.
Sure.
So how did you want to do this? Is it going to be mostly interview or just sort of talking, casual?
I think we'll go kind of back and forth. You know, I think we'll keep it a little loose and free form, just so that it doesn't detract from the game, and we're having a good time with it. We can also leave it open to questions. Hi there, Killer Kook. How are you? There we go. So we have the SSGCV. I have to admit, I can still not beat the last boss in this game.
Oh yeah.
And it gets to me. But we got it. I'm getting
maybe
there.
Maybe I
with
can
it,
help you
know.
Help you get through it.
Yeah.
Are you still playing on easy or?
I play on normal usually.
Okay.
Alrighty. So okay, I think we're named. You and I are on the ship. We got Lang over there. Advanced edition content is enabled, and then we'll start. So, when you were approaching the advanced edition, was it more or less a thing that you decided to do because you now had the time and the money to do it, or was it just something like, let's make the version we wanted to make?
It started out as a large, like a fixed patch. Basically, we did have some time and we knew we were going to have to do an update anyways because we were going to be working on the iPad version. Mm-hmm. So it just started out as, let's do some of the stuff that we put off forever, like the whole, well, crew movement, like the repositioning button, those two buttons that got added, and a few small changes. And then once we got Andrew on the team, well, you know, Andrew helping to port the game, we found that we had a whole lot of free time, so we just started like, yeah, why don't we just add this, and then why don't we add this, and then eventually it got so large that it became effectively like a whole expansion's worth of content.
Well, I have to say, these two buttons that you mentioned, they really do change the game when it comes to fast decision making with your crew. Especially
yeah.
In situations where you're just really not sure who goes where anymore, or who's got the right skills. Everybody's got crew positions. I love that. It's very helpful.
Yeah, initially we were against doing that because we didn't want any automation of any sort, because then you can sort of open the black box of Pandora's box of, you know, like, well, why can't you automate some of the movements of fixing or whatever? And so we tried to just stay away from it altogether, but the iPad version really necessitated it, so we decided to just go forward with it.
Alright, so we have a conspicuous pirate ship. Should we hail them, attack them, or quickly prepare to jump away?
Just attack.
Yeah.
Forget diplomacy.
Yeah, screw it. We'll Captain Kirk it. Alright. So, I will say that I also do like seeing that people get experience on the side, too. That's always kind of nice. Just so you can see, you know, kind of a visual representation of what's happening.
For a lot of the small changes with Advanced Edition, it was just a lot of, I don't know, sort of no-brainer things. Like, when we look back at it, and like, why didn't we do that from the start? Or, like, I can't even, when we were working on the Advanced Edition, because it did take almost, like, a year, like, it was just hard seeing people, like, stream or videos of people playing the original version, because it's just, like, there's some just simple usability stuff that just was just sort of painful to see, because once we got accustomed to it, like, the same way that originally we didn't have those, like, crossbars when a room got out of oxygen. It was just this sort of light tint change, and so once we added that, it was, like, hard to picture.
Yeah.
That it was ever anything less clear.
So here's a good question. When you start with your ship, do you build anything right off the bat, or do you start making things better? Because I always did shields and engines.
Usually the rule of thumb is, especially on normal hard, is a whole another ball game. But you don't need to upgrade anything with most ships until Sector 3. Like, by Sector 3, once you get over there, you want two shields. But before then, I just stockpile money. Usually for the first sector and maybe the second sector, I stockpile money in case I run across a store that has something that really will flesh out a build I want.
All right. Okay. That's interesting. So let's try it that way then. You're the expert after all. I'll defer to you. So find yourself kind of going through the map, like, up and down, just to kind of, like, get experience before making your way to the exit?
Yeah, it's pretty much required. We unfortunately don't really convey it in the gameplay, but it is almost required that you farm as much as you can before the exit. Mm. And what that usually means is you do want to go through Nebula as often as possible, because the fleet, because you basically get double amount of jumps before then you get there.
Really?
For the fleet. Yeah, because when you're in a except the Nebula sectors, whenever you're in a Nebula square, the Rebel fleet moves at about half the speed. The only problem in the counter that design wise is that the Nebula sector or Nebula nodes more frequently are empty, so it's a bit of a strain on your fuel supplies.
I would imagine so. Yeah, they do provide an extra challenge when it comes down to it. We got a border. We can't let our engineer get killed.
Yeah, you should probably just target his weapons as soon as possible, because your shields are down.
There we go.
I guess I'm in the past. It's hard to give suggestions in the past.
Let's see, okay, well, Hillhome says that the first jump store is always something that ticks him off. And I can kind of see that.
It's just a waste of a fuel and a jump, eventually.
Yeah.
Especially if it traps you.
Oh, I would imagine so. Oh, that does, that's a good point, Madwell, but I think that does add to the difficulty, and not being able to see what's going on inside your ship kind of adds to the scariness inside a nebula, so you don't know what's wrong with your ship.
Don't forget to repair a shield.
Right. We haven't been playing for very long, BBC, so you are just in time. Let's get this guy over here.
Just for people. My name's Justin. I'm one of the two primary developers on the game, although we did have some extra help for, like, the music and some of the writing and some of the iPad porting, but Yes, so if you have any questions about, like, you know, development or whatever, you can. It's pretty open.
Yes, please ask any questions. I'm a terrible host. I'm sorry. please ask any questions. This is kind of what we do on our site. We're going to try and start doing this a little bit more, but any design, any game-making questions, anything like that, please feel free to ask. That's kind of what we're here doing this for. Ooh, crowd control missions. I'm always so scared of these. They remind me of Oregon Trail.
I wouldn't... It's a 50-50 chance you'll lose somebody, so it's up to you.
All right, well, we'll ignore this one, because, you know, two of the people are us, and we don't want that to happen, you know.
Any more fire-based weaponry? Well, we did add the fire drone, didn't we? Yeah, we did add that, the fire combat drone. I don't really know if there's any super interesting ways to play with fire other than what we have.
There's no way we're going to give each other up to slavers. That's just mean. We can't do that.
No.
So we got to get rid of the slavers. I do like finding slavers, though, because then it gives you more crew.
Pretty much, yeah. Almost guaranteed. Are we going to add in any more stuff? Probably not. Because the way we're viewing this is we didn't really want to, like, enter into the way some game developers just sort of work on the same thing and improve it over years and years. We kind of viewed this as like, hey, look, we made something that's fun, let's move on. And the fact that we added the advanced edition was a little, it's kind of surprised ourselves that we were able to devote so much more time into working on it again, but it was fun anyways. And so I can't say that it's impossible that we'll return and add stuff, but it's definitely not on our plan right now. We're looking forward to just sort of messing around with some new ideas, I guess.
So are you kind of for the idea of kind of just making a project and then kind of moving on, like just kind of a one-shot idea?
I mean, it's funny, like this was supposed to be a three-month game. It was just, we're going to make something tiny in 3 months, and then it turns out, if you count up till now, you know, it's a three-year focus of my life is devoted to this game. So I'm definitely looking, you know, like, because we're just hoping to make a whole number of small stuff and just have fun, and we're both kind of paranoid about, like, starting another project, because then does that mean, is it going to be another big thing, or how do we approach something so that it doesn't go so totally out of control and become a huge thing?
Right. BBC, I am not using any mods. We're playing the base version of the Advanced Edition, to answer your question. Sorry, I didn't answer it before. I saw you ask that. We got another crew member. We got a Mantis crew member.
Nice.
So where do you usually
put... You're low on missiles, though.
We are low on missiles. We should probably hit up a... we can't hit up a store now. They are in
but
the red
just,
area.
Yeah, but the real key to winning this game is damage and, like, resource use mitigation. So it's more about reducing damage done to you than winning outright, usually, because it's all about the scrap. It's all about the scrap. That was a ton of questions. Hold on. Stuff like charge beam, chain fire beam. See, I don't know how we'd... Like, I like some of the mods and the way they, like, totally experiment with using what we have and coming up with weird stuff out of it, and just as many weird iterations as possible. But what we were trying to go for is just sort of really concise, clean, as few duplicate things as possible. And so I don't see what any of those weapons would provide that would be a different experience than the one that it is, other than, you know, firing twice or firing more or, you know, stuff like that. So I don't know. We have, in my view, it would have to bring something new to the table.
Trying to milk this sector for all I can, really.
Yeah, that's totally the way you gotta play usually. Where is Matthew from? Yeah, he always has an issue with people confused about his accent. He's actually just from LA, the US, so his accent. is more just a, I don't know, birth or personal development thing than a, than somewhere's accent. Well, I think his family is from Britain, though. At least one side. Hillholm says, will you guys be making a new roguelike game sometime? I have no idea what we'll do as a, Oh, you're gonna need somebody else on that oxygen. Hold on. In the past, it looks like you do it. Everything that I want to make personally is like a roguelike mechanic derivative. Like, I just want to add roguelike to everything. Like a shmup or a Zelda or a strategy game or whatever. I just love them. But, you know, roguelike in this term is just like, what the heck does roguelike mean? It could mean literally a game that's like, you know, rogue, or it could just mean the spirit of the difficulty and the permadeath and the hunger clock and the randomization. So,
right. And what do you think is the hardest or the biggest challenge in making a roguelike game?
A roguelike or a roguelike-like? We should.
Yes.
Or a rogue-ish. I guess to define. Okay, so roguelike officially means, you know, like ASCII key, like dungeon, and let's say rogue-ish or whatever.
Rogue Legacy,
like Splunky,
would that be one?
And Rogue Legacy and FTL, okay. And man, what's the Wrath of the Lamb, the Binding of Isaac. And I guess maybe the hardest thing is finding the balance so that the progression of over time, if it really is truly random and it's not like customizing the game as you go based on how you're playing, getting that balance of difficulty progression plus what sort of benefits that they give you over time, the equipment they give you, and all that sort of stuff, and making that accessible to as most amount of people as possible is maybe the hardest thing. Because, like, you know, there's people who play this and say the game, obviously there's many, many people who just say it's just too hard, it's just not even fun at all. And there's other people who just play it the first time, they beat it on normal, and they're like, I don't get it, what's the big deal? And so riding that line of difficulty is probably one of the hardest things. Like, I think Splunky got it perfectly, for example.
Yeah, Splunky was good. It did that.
Yeah. So you probably, like, for a guy like this, you just do lasers on the weapons, and it's boring, but, like, that's... although I guess you missed that time. But, yeah, it's just how you... you save money and
right now, yeah. It's, you can obviously see why I have never beaten the final boss.
Yeah, no worries. And you also, like, just leaving the mantis in the actually the mantis wouldn't make sense just because he'd be the guy fighting him, but leaving him in the door room, for example, just in case there's a border and you're caught off guard, you can hopefully get a few seconds of him in an airlock, for example.
Right, so would he be best, like, I guess, in the middle here, then?
In manning the doors or the sensors. People, like, sort of bash on the usefulness of... Oh, nice find, by the way. Bash on the usefulness of the extra sensors, but I think it's really useful to if you're playing based on what the enemy's doing, like what rooms they're in and like when you should be hitting the shields, or like, hey, you know they're not even repairing it, so you don't even need to bother. So I think it's really useful seeing into their rooms, but in general, people just, it's probably better just to leave them in the door, the door subsystem.
BBC, do we not have video? I don't have any drop frame problems here on my end.
Yeah, I see it, at least okay. On my side. I lost the old questions. Somebody asked if I've played with mods, and I like test them, and I just see what they do, but usually I find it really weird, and
really?
It's very awkward to me.
Seeing what people do to your game.
Yeah, it's well, some of it's awesome, like seeing people who are like making art that are sort of trying to be in line with with the sort of style that I worked with, or just going all in and doing crazy stuff like that. Both of that's really exciting, but usually it's a little weird gameplay wise, I think. At least from my experience.
Well, it's really great to see so many people on the stream. Thanks, guys, for coming out. And do keep asking questions. We love hearing them. Oh, there's a store. Finally. Store in the Nebula. I bet they don't get much business out here.
Yeah, not out there. Slugs dealing.
We kind of lost you there. You still with us?
Can you hear me now?
There we go. All right. Should we sell the combat drone?
I would sell it. Or just sell it, you know. Well, actually.
So fix all, I would think. Fix all, buy a bunch of missiles.
I would avoid buying missiles if possible, and try and get by with what you have.
Alright.
And if you really want to mess around, I would... Especially if it's on normal, I'd get, like, mind control just for fun.
Okay. Get mind control... You think hacking stun?
Hacking stun's really fun, but it's really hard to use, and usually only... I wouldn't suggest it.
What do you think? Oh, I think advanced FTL might help.
No. That one's totally... not good, unfortunately. it was good for the way jumping used to work and the way exploring used to work, but we kept it, and there's no real reason to ever use it, unfortunately.
Okay.
Let's see. Wheeled Warrior asks, have you got any tips for someone who hasn't ever beaten the flagship on easy? Well, if you have cloaking level 1, and then you use that right when the special drones come out, or the special shot thing in phase 3 comes out, then it'll come back in time to basically use it in the next one. And so that's one way to mitigate some damage. In general, the best way to beat it is just to get... The problem with people on easy is, like, because it is kind of... the scale of enemies is a little bit slower, that you can get severely underpowered but still be able to beat the enemies as you go. So the way to beat it on easy is just farm the heck out of each sector and just get a ton of scrap and just upgrade like crazy. That's how you beat it on easy, because there's so much scrap potential. They just jump in every square as possible, stay in the sector as long as possible, and get as much scrap as possible. That's really the way to win on any of them, but especially on easy.
Do you feel that the game translates well to a mobile device like an iPad?
iPad, yes. It wouldn't work at all on phones or anything. I think, honestly, I like the iPad version the most. I think
really?
It turned out really, really better than expected.
Ah, they got away. Let's see, what is it? Vashakur. Final boss identical to normal, right? Do you think you might have been a bad idea since people breeze through easy and then aren't prepared for the boss levels of difficulty?
Yeah, we never, like, when we balanced the game, originally when we were making it, none of the beta testers were ever playing on easy. I barely ever tried it. It was just terribly balanced for easy. And the big issue is that, like, I wanted to keep the boss the same because I wanted it to be learning ground. But the problem is you can get to the boss and be severely weaker than anyone who would get to the boss on normal. So it didn't teach you the skills to beat it. It just taught you that, you know, it's an insurmountable force. And what really should have been taught is how to get scrap like that. So it was definitely a failure, and part of the reason why we changed it, you know, for this new version.
Wheel Warrior, what do you like about the iPad version? Do you like that it's mobile, or does it control very well for you?
I'm gonna post a thing on the FTL Reddit, just a link.
Oh, that's a good idea. Whew, you're getting knocked around.
Yeah, with, oh man, going away for a second.
Going yeah, right? It's, everything yeah, goes to crap.
Get the shields on and get your engines on and just try and jump.
Yeah, it looks like the, I don't know why I'm not piloting.
Because your engines are off, because you had minimal power.
There you go. Fix that guy. Oh no! See, this is what happens. This is what happens when you leave me, man. I don't have you tell me what to do. I screw up.
Yeah, well, it's hard also because I'm all, I don't know how to tell you because I'm in the past. Oh, it's all going to hell.
Oh no! You're driving. Oh no! Who's Alex? We both died. Now it's the red shirts in charge. We're screwed.
Here, you can survive. You can pull out of this. Get in the piloting. Your shields are on, so technically they can't ever damage you. So just turn your oxygen on. He's going to die in the piloting as well.
Okay, why'd my oxygen go off? What the hell happened there? Do this real quick.
Because your oxygen's still off.
Right.
And, so depower the med bay, get the oxygen on, and then just...
There we go. Now we're cooking the
Well,
gas.
Frankly, because he can't hurt you, all you gotta do is just take your time and repair up the weapons and then blow them out of the water. Yeah, and frankly, although it's awkward when streaming, the best way to get better at the game is basically pausing all the time.
Really?
Yeah. Is like anytime anything happens, pause, think about what should be done in that situation, and
no, that's not gonna work.
I honestly don't know why. Oh, there's a breach. Close all your doors. Just hit the close all button. There's a breach above the weapons room, which is why all these rooms with the doors that are
that
open
makes
don't have
sense. Everybody knows what to do, and I don't. This is great. This is better than Twitch Plays Pokemon. Everyone's like, no, it's not.
there's that zero punctuation thing on FTL recently, and somebody on Reddit was talking about a way to play the game where, you know, you have two people playing, and, well, one person's playing the game, but he can't make any decision on his own, and the other person basically has to yell at him to do everything.
Exactly.
And I thought that would be an absolute hilarious way.
Backseat
really just,
piloting?
Just go repair weapons. And because he can't hurt you, just send both
right.
your guys repair weapons, and then get. Then all you need to do is just send your burst laser on his weapons room, and eventually he'll die. And we can talk about other stuff in the meantime. Yeah, but I mean the FTL is hard, and like some people, the way I play, especially if I'm trying to win, I you know, if I take like 4 damage in the first jump, I'll just quit, right, and I'll restart, which is frankly sad if not particularly fun. And I think I like the way that some people play, which is like I got through 3 fights, I ended up with 1 crew member, we have no weapons, we have no nothing, and you know, I still stuck with it. And oh yeah, so you have to depower your oxygen to just get your burst laser going. And just keep an eye on it. Don't depower your shields.
Okay.
That's the thing you shouldn't depower.
I think there we go. Ah, we're good.
So you'd have to shut off your engines and your oxygen and only have your shields and your weapon going. And so if you really want to micromanage, then, well, yeah, and it's fine. See, because you're both in the ion, in the ion storm, the enemy ships actually function the same as you, so they have half power, which is why he's using only one of his weapons. So, for example, in this situation, if you were to attack, let's say, his shields, once his shields go down, he's going to power up his engines more, and he's going to power up his shields more. So, yeah, that someone, Rental Brain, has it right, that, yeah, you just... If you took to attack the piloting right now, then there's no way that you would lose as well, because you would because once the piloting goes down, he doesn't have extra power to play with, since it's a subsystem.
Right.
But I just said take out his weapons, because then once you get his weapons down, you'd be able to switch your power to your oxygen so that you don't die. But hopefully you'll take him out before that. Yeah, there you go. So just turn on your oxygen and your engines and get the heck out of here.
Yep. Yeah, everybody's going to live. Except maybe Alex.
Not your med bay, your oxygen. You don't need your med bay on most.
Oh, why did I turn that? Ah. Son of a gun. They're all dead. It's dead. boy. Get there, Alex! Oh, I screwed it up. I screwed it up. Jill, the lone survivor, Mantis. There's still a breach, I bet. That's probably.
Yeah, there's still the breach next to the oxygen room.
Look at her, just forever. Forever healing.
Just close the doors and it'll be fine. You'll just never be able to repair anything with one person.
Anyway, all right, we'll restart that. That was terrible. That's my bad, everybody.
Yeah, warm up. Jill right. Is actually the name of Matt's cat.
Oh, now we know where we're going. Now we know where we're going. All right. See if we'll have better luck than having two nebula sectors to jump to after sector one. All right.
Yeah, select sectors, like, normally people don't, if you just want another tip, normally people don't, like, upgrade your med bay or your oxygen or your piloting, but frankly, if you jump to, if you're in a nebula sector, I would suggest getting one in your oxygen if you have the extra money. So this is a pretty tough fight for level one.
What is it, the sun and the automated,
And he hits your shields in the first shot. So you need to repair those ASAP or you're going to be screwed.
Right. That's why I got, oh boy.
Definitely send both people. El Nub Nub, he was one of our backers.
Oh, was he?
Yeah. A lot of the weird names are our backers. Wow, this game does not want you to win. Look at this. there's no way one person will put out two fire before he dies, usually.
Oh god, why there's so many fires? I think we're now just hoping that we'll be able to jump out of sector.
Yeah. This is an even worse start.
There we go, we got shields up. Oh, the engines! No! Oh god, everything's on fire.
Yeah, if you, so if your shields are down when the solar flare goes off, you get, like, six rooms catch on fire. If
wow, really?
Yeah, if your shields are up, then you get one or two rooms on fire. So basically, it's 100% necessary for you to have your shields up. I think each room that gets put on fire has a 1 in 3 chance of actually taking a damage as well. So yeah.
Let's go back to the start. Get out of this zone. Here we go.
Poitaman. I really likes projectiles, can hit drones and other projectiles. That initially is one of those things, like, the bugs that are features. It was just the way, oh man, this is so bad. That was some serious death.
Right. But, here, let's go to the med bay. Everyone's dead.
That came about from the, just the, initially we're actually having the game potentially act where you're, you could be moving around in a 2D space. So you actually choose where the ship is moving, you choose the position based on where the enemy ship is. Kind of inspired by Weird Worlds, if anybody's played that. And then so you were able to target drones, you were able to, there's a lot of things that were different in that time. And so that was like a bleed over of the old style mechanic of being able to target weapons and try and shoot them out of the air and all that kind of stuff. And so it's 100%, you know, luck at this point, but we just left it in there. I guess if you're really good, you could try and time a shot perfectly as it went by, but just target his weapons. Don't even bother with anything else.
But it definitely would have made it interesting being able to stop an attack.
So you know. So with this guy, you could see, like, you have to analyze what's the priority of attacking. So him. He has a missile weapon and then a beam drone. So the beam drone can never get through you unless he takes down your shield. So the only thing that you need to worry about is taking down that missile. And then once that's down, you can worry about other stuff. Or if you're lazy, especially in these early levels, and you're just chilling, you just auto-fire on his weapons, because then he can't do anything else to you. And so you just plow through his weapons, because clearly he has somebody repairing it really fast. It takes longer, but it's the guaranteed way to win with zero damage, which is a priority when you're trying to.
Right.
Of course, this guy's jumping, so you'd need to change that eventually.
Yeah, I mean, it would have, I think, added a little extra difficulty if you were able to shoot things out of space before it got to you. But I think you're right. I think that's kind of not what this is kind of about, I suppose.
Yeah, I mean. The story of developing FTL is just streamlining the game. It's just making everything smoother and simpler and cutting away and all that sort of stuff over time. And so, like most, the game is a tenth of what we were initially planning or something. So, but I think it's better for it because it's not bloated and the mechanics are sleek and stuff like that. And so, you know, having not being able to target drones and weapons and basically focusing on this whole two-screen, almost Tetris-like, you know, I have a player area, and he has a player area, and then you just lob stuff back and forth. So it makes, focusing on that definitely makes the game much smoother, I'd say.
So, I Love Brownies 3 asked, where was the inspiration for coming up with the names of the guns that all had Greek god names?
Gosh, I don't remember. A lot of the... I named most of the weapons, and it's hard to say. I think I named the Artemis missile first, and I was just thinking like a bow, and it's like a piercing arrow, and, it, you know, the one shot that saves you kind of thing.
Yeah.
So... then it was just a thing, and like, okay, I name missiles after people or gods. Is Leto actually a god of some sort? I actually named it after Dune. and then the beams named after, you know, I think I named the halberd first, and then I just sort of stuck with that and just found other sort of long pole-like weapons or whatever.
Now, you spoke before about, you know, cutting things out of games and things like that. Is it hard to think about what to cut? Like, making those decisions?
Usually, for most things, it's pretty easy. Most things, it's But then every once in a while, there's something that's just really hard to cut and really unhappy making. So I guess it depends. Like, for ages, I wanted to add like this lightning weapon in, and like that got cut like 3 times. And, I don't know. Most things that got cut really needed to be, frankly. But then there were some other things that were hard, like the having customizable ships was something that we had sort of talked about in the Kickstarter, and we weren't able to do that in the long run, and so that was hard to cut. But well, we tried it, and it was just garbage, frankly. We couldn't find a way to make it fun. So it was sad to see that go, but the backers were all very forgiving in that sense.
So this is actually the little short circuiting thing is new. I've actually never encountered that other than the last game that we were playing.
Yeah, so hacking, it's one of the advanced edition changes, and it's a drone that gets launched and it'll target a system and it'll perform a negative a debuff for duration, sort of like cloaking. And it's different depending on each system it hit. Cloak hacking is interesting because this is something that we planned to add in the very beginning and just could not figure out a way to make it fun. And it must have gone through maybe 5 or 6 like total change iterations. Like, it was this sort of, for a while it was like this sort of node structure of power that goes between each rooms, and you sort of choose the destination of your little hacking nodes, and they go through and they slowly depower most things in the ship. And then what else did it do? There's a lot of weird things. Eventually, we really didn't want to make it custom for each room, but eventually, once we found this one, it was by far the best way to do hacking. We were about ready to cut it before Matt came up with this idea.
You think we should get the ion bomb here?
The ion bomb is one of the best weapons, but it's sort of a late game weapon. I'd say you kind of need to survive the early game before you play that ion bomb.
Oh, I see what you're saying. I hear. I get it. I know what you're really saying.
That one comes in. It's not as. I mean, it's useful early on, but you have the Artemis missile, which is in the early stages, just fine.
What about the reverse ion field, protecting us from 50% chance to negate its energy?
Most augments is not really worth buying early on. It's okay. Usually because early on you want to get up scrap for 2 things, defense and offense. And then once you're okay, that's when you start filling it out with like upgrading your piloting and your doors a little bit here and there. Usually, like if I see a if you see like a one of the special augments, like the ones that give you 50% off. 50% chance of not using a missile weapon or something like that. Sometimes I get those early because then it structures how you want to play the rest of the game. You're like, all right, now I'm playing with missiles, or now I'm playing with drones. But usually I don't spend the scrap on them.
Do you think we should repair or just bounce?
I'd repair personally.
Fix all?
Yeah. Well, yeah. Usually the way you min-max the game, I'd say the best way is to always leave 5 to 10 unrepaired, because there's those events that repair you periodically. But in the early sector, since it only costs 2, it's just as good just to repair all in the first 2 sectors, in my opinion.
All right.
But I honestly, there are a lot of people who are better than me. like I've been watching like Lethal Frag play the game. He's like he's beat it with most ships on hard without pausing the game, and it just freaking blows my mind. Zippy Dragon, can you re-add the augment that would teleport your crew back on your ship when your enemy's ship jumps? I don't remember there ever being an augment, and maybe that's... Is that a mod? I don't think mods would be able to do that. Maybe they'd be able to. I don't recall there being such a thing. Killer Kook asked about some of the old ideas I talked about previously. About station and docking. Yeah, a lot of that stuff Yeah, I agree. It would be really cool, but it would be such a change to the game that it's not even worth it. So this guy, you could see, he has. You're really not getting much luck, but he's got a defense drone too, right? So what that does is it'll shoot down your missiles first of all, and it'll also shoot down one volley of your lasers. So, and just theory-wise, he has two weapons that are the same, which means when they keep firing, they'll keep firing at the same time, which means they'll go through your shields. But because you damage them once, now they fire off skew. They don't coincide because the AI isn't good enough to time his weapons. So in that situation, it would be important to like damage the weapons once until they're off skew, and then you can basically ignore them because they'll never get through your shields at all. Just in theory. People normally don't like the defense drone too because it isn't guaranteed to shoot down your missiles because it could be busy shooting down other stuff. But I freaking love the defense drone too.
When you're doing the rebels who try and run away, for those guys, is it really just they charge up the FTL drive like you do? Is it the same time, or do they have a quicker FTL charge than you do?
They have a slower FTL charge. I think it's like, for most of them, it's like 20 or 30 seconds or something. It's a set time, but if you damage their piloting, or if they don't have a pilot, or their engines are broken, then it also doesn't charge. And it also charges at a rate based on the amount of engines they have on. So if they have 7 engines, it's going to charge really fast, for example. So, I think it's been a long time, but so it is beneficial to damage them. Although almost always you basically need to break it, or else they'll get away. Luigi asks, did it always have a pause button? Yes, this game always had a pause button. It was pretty much intended from the start. Almost the start, and maybe the first few weeks of them, just because we were playing with the fine line of we wanted to be feeling like it could get hectic, but we didn't want it to feel like you're getting overwhelmed. And so, if you're able to play the game without pause, it would need to be able to be a little bit slower paced, so that A, you could react, and B, you can control your crew without having to be like a StarCraft master. And so, if we wanted to run that fine line between too complex versus not interesting enough or too boring, you'd have to have a pause button, in my opinion. So that will allow us to have those periods when you're having those crazy hectic battles, and if you're a good player, you can pause and you can think and you can sit there and you'd be able to react and make decisions accordingly. Because the real thing we're trying to get for the player is, like, getting in a situation and you sit there and you're like, what do I do here? And if you make the right decisions, then 9 times out of 10, you'll be able to get out of there alive. And so, unless you're just totally, bones. Rental Brain asked about programming the AI of the flagship hacking right after they cloak. No, that's just them being jerks. That was not really intentional. The AI is actually really stupid. It's just terribly, terribly stupid. But it's stupid in a way that's kind of randomized, so that every once in a while it seems like they're smart. So and that's kind of intentional.
So in this early game, would you suggest going Engi-controlled or NG-controlled to Mantis?
Well, just to go back with that fuel stop where you can buy 6 fuel for 12 scrap or something like that, always buy as much as possible. Like, unless you have, like, 30 fuel or you're at the final sector or whatever, just that's a no-brainer. Like, that is so good that you should always buy it, basically.
Got it.
And I would definitely go NG-controlled.
So how do you pronounce it? I've heard debates.
We say NG. The funny thing, I always thought it was a silly name.
So go with that. Apparently, it's like right now.
Yeah, definitely go NG controlled. The civilian sectors, and especially NG controlled, have more nodes that are just like straight up gives you stuff, and also they're a lot easier fights. if you're not, you know. I mean, there's those people who could just ignore borders because they're so accustomed to it, but for normal people, I'd say it's easier fights.
Should we get a hacking?
I wouldn't. You only have 8 drones. It wouldn't be useful for a good portion.
Okay, so let's see. So, repair.
If you look at what the drone control has, if it has a behind times, but if it had a defense drone, it may be worthwhile.
Yeah, it's just a combat one.
Yeah, then maybe not.
So, do you think we should get the NG for our shields?
I would hold off, because you need... You know, you've been having trouble. I just say upgrade your shields. Upgrade your shields, too, and upgrade and get 2 engines. Not engines.
Alright, so... Shields, 2, you said?
So, 2 shields and then 2 reactors, so you could power it.
Alrighty. There we go.
Defense drone 1 shouldn't be less reliable. There was an issue in an advanced edition. It did have to be changed from some other drone changes, which made it have problems, which meant we went back and changed it to fix it. But we were testing it, and I think it's exactly the same. I had the same feeling. I felt like it wasn't as good, but that our testing and statistics seem to show that it's the exact same thing, so it's hard to say. Oh, yeah, Zippy Dragon, yeah. Those things he found were just a list of potential things of augments in the code that I had just written down in the XMLs to just be, like, hoping that we eventually get to, but that was one of the things that we never bothered with. There's a couple of those that we never added that were still in those old, in that old code, which is funny that people can go find those.
Yeah, it's interesting when people can go into the code like that and see things that, you know, maybe they weren't meant to see or weren't, you know, were ideas but weren't.
Yeah, initially it felt really awkward to have the people go in there and dig around and break stuff and just mess around. Because it's like someone going through your underwear door. Not a lot of that stuff is, like, refined. The scripting system is pretty garbage. And so it was really awkward, but it's our fault for not making it more mod friendly, I suppose. We never really anticipated.
Woo! Okay. So one of these border drone guys, what would you suggest with one of the anti-personnel drones?
If he's in a room you don't need, just ignore him.
But he's in the engine room.
Yeah, just ignore him. You could send somebody in there just to sort of take some damage every once in a while and then heal him up, but I would just finish off the ship. Just make sure he doesn't take out your oxygen system.
Right.
Because the real problem with fighting him in the room that he lands in is that there's a breach there, so eventually your crew will start taking more damage. So if you let him destroy it, and yeah, you'll take a damage, but he'll leave the room and you could fight him in an oxygen-filled room. If you really wanted to fight him. But otherwise, you could just... This enemy ship is so weak, you could just damage the drone system and shut him off. And then once you destroy the ship, he'll be destroyed and you can fix the breach. I don't know why the site is down. Our frickin'... We've been having so much trouble with with DreamHost. Don't ever use DreamHost. It's garbage. Like, we triple the amount of bandwidth for when we launched AE, and still crashed, and we had all these problems, and they never fixed it. And even though we told them the XYZ is the problem, and they just wouldn't fix it. And every time we contacted them, there was somebody else who said the same thing, and they're like, "Yes, we did all that. It's just garbage. We really want to switch, but it would be a huge hassle at this point."
So I'm figuring we don't give them any scrap, yes?
It's way too early. That's too. If you're later on, like, and you have a surplus, but I wouldn't give anything this early. Because events like this, the amount of scrap that they're asking for doesn't change. So if you're in like Sector 7 and you stockpile like, you know, 170 scrap or something, you're probably, you're fine. Yeah, but early on when that 40 scrap equals, you know, another shield bubble.
Right, and we got lucky for the Mantis encounter. We actually got a repair arm.
Oh, I missed that. Yeah, repair arm, it's funny, I hate it, but Matt loves it. And
really?
I know that other people are, like, iffy about it, but, so what it does is it removes, it. Every time you get scrap, you get, I think, 15% less scrap, but it heals your ship. So, early on, it's really good. Later on, by the end, you want to ditch it, usually. But, like, in general, it saves you not having, you don't have to go to the store, you don't have to repair, all sorts of stuff. FTL was written in C++. The reason why we started this whole thing, I wouldn't even go to the store, yeah, you're perfect. But, Matt was working on this game because he was sick of working on other people's code, and he wanted something that he could work just entirely on his own, make all of his own decisions, didn't want to use anything proprietary, all that sort of stuff. And so, yeah, it's a blessing because Matt knows absolutely everything about what's going on in the background, but it's also bad because, why is it bad? It's like, it's really weak. Like, the rendering system doesn't use anything fancy. It's just literally just drawing the pixels, which is super heavy on the CPU, which is why, you know, people say, I could run game like Team Fortress 2, or I can run like, you know, what's that Unreal game on iPad where you play, you know, you're slashing the sword and you're fighting those fancy looking beautiful art. And you're like, I can run that game, but FTL chugs. And the reason is because it's not using the it's not using the graphics processing unit at all, basically. Because there's no analysis on that. It's just straight up drawing pixels, which is totally different.
Should we get rid of the drone?
Yeah, I would just ditch that. Just get subscribed.
Then we should we get the mind control?
I'd say no. I'd say let's focus on main stuff. Get you and like an when the opportunity arises, some low power laser weapon, and just start upgrading stuff over time.
So should we get some more another power bit for our engines?
I'd hold off because you're strong enough to keep going for a bit. I hold off until to see if you can get any whatchamacallit. If you can find any lasers for sale. Although they're getting a mess of it may be worth it in the long run. I don't think that's a hard call.
Ooh, shield overcharger.
I love that drone. Some people don't love it so much.
Oh god, no, no giant alien spiders. No. Those are the scariest one. You lose, like, a bunch of your crew.
Yeah, maybe we should have just added that augment that you guys are talking about. It's small enough. But I don't know why we didn't.
Which
one? It just didn't seem important. They're talking about, like, a augment where you get your crew back if you jump... Or the enemy jumps and they're on the enemy ship.
Mantis or Rock?
Sector?
Mm-hmm.
Let's see. How good are you at fighting borders?
Ooh, good point. Rock then?
Actually, go Rock, because you have the repair arm. And the problem with Rock is that they have more missile weapons, which means just more constant damage. And since you have the whatever arm, the repair arm, it'll mitigate that a bit. Yeah, people are surprised when that FTL has such high requirements, but it the problem with FTL is I don't know how techie you guys are, but it has its graphics is controlled by OpenGL, OpenGL 2, and which is just, you know, like open source. Basically, everyone everywhere supports it, is the thought. Everyone everywhere except for like AMD. Like AMD like did not update OpenGL at all, and so it just doesn't work at all. It's funny we're talking about borders and then finding it. So the theory here, well, not if you're, so get your pilot, you do want to jump, probably.
Where should I jump?
Somewhere that looks safe.
none of them do. Honestly, so I would jump this, back to the start.
Yeah, if you want to be really safe, why not? But, what I would, usually the distress signals are, it's a good chance of being safe, but, jumping back would definitely set you back a long time of the fleet, but whatever. But yeah, fighting that situation, I would just straight up vent the whole back half of the ship, which would force the rock people to go, hopefully, into your med bay, and then you just fight in your med bay, and it's a guaranteed victory.
There we go, we're good now.
Yes.
Oh, my doors are all messed up, so I can't open them.
Yeah, Clone Bay. We were thinking about having it save you when you jump, but that thematically doesn't make sense. It's copying people who died recently, so if they're in some other part of the galaxy, it wouldn't count. I'm in the past, but I would pause and vent through the shield. Well, I wouldn't vent anymore because your oxygen's off and you're not going to get that oxygen back, but that means the fire will burn out, hopefully. But one thing you can do also is if you... too late now, but if you send somebody into the doors room when the fire is spreading, it'll actually prevent the fire from spreading through doors.
That's right.
Because the blast doors will prevent fire spread. So it's a bit more of an advanced, I guess. But if I were you, I would just, because the fire is kind of getting out of hand, just stick all your guys in the med bay and vent the whole ship. That's just... Then that's just the easy way to deal with it.
I gotta fix the doors, though.
Oh, yeah, good, right, of course. One thing you can also do is if you turn off your oxygen and just, the fire actually burns oxygen, like theoretically it would. And so it will make it deplete oxygen faster. So if you just turn off your oxygen system, any room that has fires, especially if your ship is already kind of low on oxygen, if there's any fires, it will burn themselves out pretty fast.
That's going to be a weird to like just be sitting thing. In a room knowing that there's like no air in your ship.
Yeah. Yeah, I like that idea. One of the original versions... If you had somebody standing in an airlock room and the doors were open, they'd get vented out into space. But,
that would actually be really funny.
Yeah, it was pretty funny the first time it happened. But the problem is, the only time it ever happens is by accident. And so.
Then you screw it up just, one time, you're like, damn.
Why do so many of the AE ships don't have sensors? There's basically like a certain amount of I assume you mean player ships, not enemy ships. Enemy ships like thematically they should have sensors, but they just don't have so many rooms. But basically, a lot of the AE ships are advanced users, and so we kind of buff the ship in some way and to sort of balance it out. That means they have need to lose something, so a lot of them lost sensors, because it's basically just means that you need an extra however much, 50 scrap to buy sensors again, and some luck to find it. And so it's just a way to make certain ships that are a little bit overpowered a little bit harder to use. Because, you know, people may think it's not necessary, but then that one time those, like, fires are spreading and you don't know it. And frankly, a lot of... Another thing, and a real benefit to upgrading sensors, is that there's a ton of blue options that use sensors. So you kind of lose out on all those, too.
Really? So just looking into certain things or seeing how bad situations really are?
Yeah, you know, like... There's ones like finding somebody in a nebula, or like rescanning over a section that you scanned over and you missed something. And so it's really helpful. Actually, a lot of the things that people don't like upgrading your midday your oxygen, but especially if you're doing okay on scrap, getting 1 point in midday and oxygen both give you a reasonable oxygen less, obviously, but both give you some blue options that are. That make life easier. Especially if you go into slug sectors, because then you'll get that one guy where he like uses fire and like boards you, and then like shuts off your med bay if you don't have level 2 med bay, and that's just hell. So
that seems like a pretty good deal to surrender.
Especially if he gives you missiles, I can't see, but missiles and fuel, it's obviously better. So the way the surrendering works is they have a higher chance of giving you materials and less scrap, generally. So it's just figuring out if that's more worthwhile for you.
Oh hey, 3 intruders.
Man. Yeah, so this would be one of those times of venting the whole ship and going... Definitely do it while you're paused.
Yeah, I put everybody in the med bay. Or at least the back crew, so I have someone steering.
Man, you're getting some harsh fights.
Right?
Isn't this like level of Sector 3 or something? This is kind of crazy. So, if they're in your shield room, you need to stop them from taking your shields down ASAP. So run your people in there to fight them while... I guess it was too late, but yeah. Because now the asteroids are going to tear you a new one.
They're both in my cockpit, though. My pilot's getting messed up.
Well, if he destroys your med bay, you're gonna lose. So you shouldn't let him do that. Already.
We're all kind of just chilling in the med bay right now. Oh, someone's not gonna make it back. Oh, you made it back, and I died. But we need you. You know what you're doing better.
Some of the guys are talking about mods. I guess this may be a good game. So, some advance to get out of this situation. Ignoring the weapons. Yeah, you'd be screwed. But if you had your guys at full health, what you generally do is you cycle them instead of sending both at once.
Right.
Because if you have one person in the room fixing it, it will maintain its repair. So you can... as opposed to having both at the same time, and then if you have to leave before it's done, then you lose all that repair. That's the theory.
This is just not happening.
Yeah. I don't see a way you can get out of this. Because you're med bay.
Oh, wow. Oh, boy. That was tough. Anyway, well, we have been streaming for a good hour and 10 minutes, Justin. You know, we can stream as long as you like, but Is there anything you want to talk about before you have to go?
I guess we'd, yeah, I should probably eat dinner, but we can just do a few more questions, see if anybody has any important questions. So they're talking about mods. I think it's awesome what the people did, and Cavan's Edition is crazy. I feel bad because we never structured the game for modding, and it's incredibly hard to mod, and their tools to like make ships and stuff is actually better than the tools that we use to make ships, so it's inspiring to see how much they could do with so little, frankly, which is pretty fun. And I love some of the crazy ideas, and there's actually been a number of things I've seen in that I'm like, I kind of want to emulate because it's so awesome, or at least make something pseudo-official, but I don't know what we'll be doing in the long run. Because part of me wants to make like tons and tons of weapons, but frankly that would change the balance so much that I'd be afraid to. It changes like how much stuff you see in stores, changes all sort of stuff, so it generally takes it slow. No, the one slug ship that did have no doors, I love that ship. It's still in there, it's just the non-pirate version of the ship that has it. So you'd need to find the actual slug ship, that's the little scout ship, but it's still in there. We just added new versions of everything. Initially, we were thinking that there would be a lot of ships that didn't have rooms to access, but that was our test run, and I didn't like it that much in terms of the gameplay mechanic, but we liked it enough just to leave it in the game. That's the only reason why it exists. There's probably not going to be any more big updates, especially the size of Advanced Edition, unless in like a year from now we're like, I miss working on FTL. But at this moment we're really burnt out. Multiplayer. Someone was spending a lot of time trying to remake the entire game to add multiplayer. And I think that stopped and he gave up at some point. But yeah, it would require, and not even counting balance changes, which there would need to be plenty. It would need an entire thing. I actually have been playing a lot of local multiplayer games like Towerfall recently, and I've been pondering, is there some sort of local multiplayer version of FTL that could be done that I could just like make in Game Maker and just using controllers and using the same art assets? I haven't come up with anything, but that would be a funny thing to do. I am not interested in working on network multiplayer though, it would be like impossible. As far as I could tell, neither of us know anything about that coding work. Something that you haven't taken advantage of that they're bringing up is if you put somebody in your doors room, it'll give you an additional power into the doors temporarily. It's only the sensors and the doors that are like that. So if you're having boarders and you want to kill them with oxygen deprivation, send somebody in your doors room temporarily, and then you get temporary blast doors. So that was something that changed in Advanced Edition. When's the Android version? I don't know. We're trying. We're talking to people about it now. And frankly, Android seems like a hellhole to develop for, because there's so much device fragmentation that. I don't know. We'll see. And I did not read the fanfiction about the guys in the medbay. You should link it.
Well, is there anything else you'd like to touch on? I mean, as far as game making is concerned, something that you learned when working on the project that you think people who are working on their own can take away or should know?
I don't know if any of these guys are game developers, but if you are, I'd say try and take part in game jams. This is something that, frankly, I grew a lot from seeing the entire process of making a game from start to finish in a super advanced time. You learn so much, especially the importance of cutting things, which we took part, which we used to our advantage in FTL as much as possible.
Well, you know, we We'd like to thank you for letting us have you on our stream. Thank you for answering questions, and thanks for putting up with me doing a terrible job at this game that I'm normally pretty good at. But you know, I want to say thanks to all of our viewers. This is probably the most viewers we've had in quite a while, so thank you very much. We hope you enjoyed the stream, and I think we might end it right there.
Yeah, thanks, guys. Definitely.
Go to our website, thegamecreatorsvault.com, to see more interviews and news, and thank you all for coming out. We really appreciate it, and we hope to see you all again next time we stream.